in screwed news. A glass of wine a day keeps the doctor away, or does it? Over the past few decades, the medical community has come around to the fact that downing a glass of wine or two with dinner might be good for your health. In fact, one recent study actually found that drinking wine was better for you than going to the gym. But all that is only true if you aren't drinking the cheap wine with way too much arsenic. This is a huge deal, and joining me now from Denver, Colorado is Mike Burg, a leader in the fight against this small part of the industry that doesn't play by the rules. Mike, is it fair to say that this case is not about the entire wine industry?
Absolutely. I'm a wine drinker. Everyone I know, my family, we're all wine drinkers. This is not an attack on the wine industry. What it's an attack on is those wineries that are selling wine for, most of these are $10 or less, and what they're doing is they have incredible amounts of arsenic in it that are way beyond the standard of 10 parts per billion for drinking water.
Okay, now let me stop you there just a second. Now the EPA came up with a standard for drinking water, and they said if you follow this standard, you're not going to get sick, it ought to be healthy, you're going to be okay. Water in California, for example, the standard, as you were pointing out, is 10 parts per billion. So now give me what's happening with wine in compared to that arsenic standard for water. What's the comparison?
Well, the comparison is that, first of all, over 1,300 bottles were tested, and we had it tested by three separate labs. 83 bottles ended up having more than double and as high as five times the amount of arsenic that would be allowed under not only the standard in California, but also the World Health Organization, which is 10 parts per billion. So as much as 50 parts per billion in many of these wines.
Now, Michael, you've always handled big cases. Let me disclose, you've invited me to be involved with this. Thank you for that. This is an important case. But let me get to the heart of some of these issues. There's the pushback from low-end. Let me stress, this is low-end wine manufacturers in this industry. They've already begun to do what we see in every lawsuit. I remember it happening in tobacco, the pushback we saw with tobacco. We see it virtually in every pharmaceutical case, saw it in the GM lawsuits when they were filed. The pushback in this case is incredible to me. The money that these few manufacturers putting in to trying to make this go away, it doesn't go away. The arsenic is in there. It's been in there for decades. And so, but they say, tell me if this is accurate, but one of their defenses is that, gee whiz, this isn't a problem because we don't drink as much wine as we do water, therefore we can't make a comparison. Did they really use that as defense in the first few days after you filed this case?
They did, and we're still hearing it. In fact, I had a debate on NPR about it. I mean, the problem with it is this. First of all, I do know people drink as much wine as water, but that's beside the point. What really the point is we have dangerous levels of poison. Arsenic is poison in your wine. And what we're saying is, look, Many of the winemakers are able to eliminate those dangerous levels, and these wineries are not eliminating it, and in fact are concealing it from the public, so the public doesn't know how much arsenic that they have in their wines because they're not complying with the labeling law in the state of California.
Michael, I've also seen the defense, which another crazy, remarkable defense, and that is, gee whiz, in Canada, they allow the parts per billion to be 100. In other parts of the world, third world countries, they allow it to be more than that. So we're supposed to be okay because they allow it in other parts of the world. Is that really one of their defenses in this case?
It is, but let me tell you, because we've been looking at that, right now there is a move in Canada to take it from 100 parts per billion to 10 parts per billion because they've talked to experts, as we've talked to experts, that anything above 10 parts per billion is dangerous and potentially has serious health risks for people who are drinking that wine.
Michael, I saw an article in Forbes magazine right when you asked me to be involved with this. Forbes, we expect this from Forbes magazine, and that is we're going to protect the industry no matter how disgusting the conduct of the industry. A, this isn't the industry. This is not the wine industry. You know, there are plenty of great wines out there. B, we know it's that small part, but they come out and they start spreading the word that this is just some hoaxy, dreamed-up lawsuit that doesn't mean anything. And you know what, Michael, let me remind you how often Forbes magazine has done that. They did it on asbestos. They did it on tobacco. They do it on almost every pharmaceutical case that comes down the pike, because they're an extension of corporate America. So are we doing anything from the consumer standpoint to get the media to pay attention to how serious this problem is?
We are, and this show is one example of that. But here's the important part, I think, for the viewers to really understand. That when we're talking about arsenic in your wine, this is not a personal injury lawsuit. This is a lawsuit to get the wine industry to change the way they label their product. The public should know how much arsenic, so they have a choice. For example, if another manufacturer such as Gallo can produce a wine that is for the same price as one of these 83 wineries that are poisoning America, that if they can produce one without having dangerous levels of arsenic, so can these wineries. And the public has a right to know, so they can decide, do I want to drink the bottle that has 5 times the limit of what should be in drinking water, or do I want to drink the one that is within the limit? That is what's important. And I also want to tell you, Mike, and our viewers, we have heard, and I can't go into it, from many of the legitimate wineries that they are happy that we have finally uncovered this, and the secret is out.
Well, let me just tell you, I've actually gotten emails with people saying that exact same thing. Everybody that has been paying attention to this case knows this: the wine industry as a whole does a really good job trying to do this right. Now, which brings me to the point. This can be done right. But the cheap wineries, the people who just want to sell this garbage, they're competing with people who do it right. So how about the winery who says, I'm going to spend that extra money, I'm going to make sure that I don't have inorganic arsenic in my wine. They're competing with the person who says, well, I don't really care, I'm going to do it anyway, I'm going to let the people down the road have to deal with this. Talk about that just a little bit.
Well, yeah, I think you've hit it right on the head, Mike, which is, here's the issue. Unlike some other lawsuits and other things, here we have seen that many, in fact, you know, 95% of the people who produce wine do it the right way. They make sure that they filter it properly. They make sure they're not putting this purple goo in. And we found that they're putting this purple goo in the wine to make it look like wine. And there it has 10 times the legal limit.
Okay, talk about the purple goo. People don't understand that. They take a base and they put this goo in it, as you described. What is that goo, and why do they put it in the base?
Well, they put it in. It's actually goo that it actually is almost a grape juice. And they put it in, they mix it in to make it look like wine. They put the alcohol in, then they put the goo in there, and they mix it up, and then they sell it as wine. And quite frankly, we've had experts who looked at it who said they don't even think that's wine. And so that's what you're drinking, that's what people are getting, and they're getting this excess amount of arsenic. And what's in there is pesticides, which is poison. I mean, we know arsenic is poison.
It's rat. They use it for rat poison. I mean,
let's be honest.
Okay, now let me ask you this. What's the difference between organic arsenic and inorganic arsenic, and why is that important in this case?
It's important. We know about the apple juice and the rice cases. Most of that was organic. It comes from the soil, and quite honestly, it's very difficult to get all the arsenic from the soil out of the wine. So every wine that you're going to drink may have a small amount in there, but the inorganic arsenic is the bad arsenic. It is, some people say it's as much as 100 times more dangerous. I've heard one expert say 500 times more dangerous. And when we got this case, so everybody understands, we did our due diligence. We got a person who sent us his results. We looked at him, we examined him. We then sent it to a second independent lab, and then we went to a third independent lab to break down organic versus inorganic. And the majority of the arsenic in the wines that we've named in this lawsuit is inorganic arsenic. And you know what? The Wine Institute and the wine industry, the people who are defendants, they don't want to talk about the difference. And there's a major difference.
Okay,
inorganic arsenic is dangerous.
Again, if I watch this case develop, why would you be somebody who does this right, who actually goes through the process correctly and looks out for the consumer? Why would you be coming to the defense of the low-end winemaker? It makes no sense to me. What we're trying to do is say, go after those folks and put them in their own little world. Hopefully that's where it goes to. Now look, let me ask you something. You talk about experts. They are loading up already, these cheap winemakers are already loading up with biostitutes. These are scientific prostitutes who are hired in universities to say anything you want them to say for the right amount of money. Are you already seeing that happening in this case? We see it almost in every case.
We are, but I must tell you, we have talked to some of the top experts in the world, epidemiologists, toxicologists, who, and in fact, if you saw the story on Good Morning America or you saw it on CBS, they went to experts at Cal Berkeley, they went to experts in other parts of the country, and they said, you don't want this level of arsenic in your wine. And so we believe the real experts will come out, and this case will be proven, unlike the hired experts that are paid for and bought to say whatever the wine industry wants them to say. And again, I want to make sure everybody understands that many, many of the wineries have said privately they are happy because they'd like to make the other wineries that are doing what they're doing and having those high level of arsenic play by the rules, the same rules to make sure the public health is protected.
Okay, Michael,
in this country.
Let's, I got about 30 seconds, real quick. Cancer, neurological disease, it's tied to that, arsenic, we know that, because it's a heavy metal. The heavy metal in the human body is cumulative. Isn't that part of the problem, depending on how much wine, how much cheap wine you drink, not how much wine you drink. I think you can drink all the wine you want. Just don't drink the cheap stuff, because cancer and neurological disease is a consideration. Real quick,
absolutely,
Mike.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Thank you very much, Mike.
Michael Burg, thanks for joining me. Hopefully we can change the way they do business in this particular industry, at least on that low-end wine maker. Thanks for joining me, okay?